thank you very much, Melissa, for your kind invitation. This is the second year that I have the opportunity to be in this highly prestigious United Nations University, thanks to the friendship with Professor Dr. Melissa Siegel. Thank you again for your invitation. And again, I was very happy last year. I was very happy also to be here and to discuss a little more about Mexico and migration. Now we are going to focus on migration. But first of all, are you, how many of you are from Mexico or Central America? Okay. Well, we can discuss with more familiarity. But the idea is to talk about mainly two things. One is what is happening with migration in relation with Mexico and the U.S., especially now with the new administration in the U.S., and also what have been my personal experiences, as Melissa said, in the Mexican consulate in Los Angeles, which is a very active office, and also in Houston, Texas, and for about 6 years as Director General of Consular Affairs and Protection of Mexicans Abroad, and later on as Ambassador to Guatemala, Central America, that is a key element in the migration policy of Mexico. But starting with migration, I want to start with some assumptions, but the most important one is this phrase that a friend of mine told me years ago, and it seems that is attributed to the great philosopher, poet, German Bertolt Brecht, in about this phrase that I think express everything that is migration. Yes, everybody taking workers, but let's what? We are talking about human beings. And being about human beings, we have a lot of situations, a lot of dramas, a lot of success, a lot of passion, a lot of feelings that are really much more beyond the possibility of having a robot as a migrant, perhaps in the future, but now we are talking about human beings. And the assumptions that I have, perhaps you will agree with me, but otherwise we can discuss this in the Q&A period, that I want to make it longer because I want you to fix the agenda. This is the first one. The history of our being in this planet is a history of migration. Migration has been with the mankind always, always. I am not going to stop on that. I think it's evident. Secondly, since the national states, the beginning of the national states, and after the Peace of Westphalia and events like that, the national states are the ones that issue the laws about migration. They define the migration policy, and usually through the issue of laws. But, of course, they have limitations, and one of the limitations is international law, especially when we are dealing about human rights. And secondly, when defining a policy of migration, states usually have to take in consideration, otherwise they are going to make a big mistake, the political, economical, humanitarian, social, and geographical considerations. This is also, for me, very obvious. Other point that we have been insisting for many, many years is that, okay, states are allowed to issue the regulations and the laws about migration, but the enforcement should be humanitarian. Why? Because we are dealing with human beings. We are not dealing with machines. And also to consider that according to the laws of every state, migration could be regular or could be irregular. Is this according to a law or not according to the law of the land? The other assumption that I want to make is that we have in migration push factors, the attraction factor, the expulsion factors of migrants. You have to leave a country because of something, usually economic reasons, but also political. Let's think about what is happening, violence or war in Syria or in the Middle East, or political, sometimes the prosecution that you are because of your the political party that you belong or whatever, religious, it's been obvious, especially, I mean, to begin with, the start of the United States in the 16th century, it was because of the religious problem. And of course, natural disasters. Central America has been very clear in the migration from Central America to the US thanks to natural disasters. So we're explaining that. But also we have the pull factors, mainly economic. Yeah, a more vibrant and a strong economy is attracting a lot of people because they need workforce. Humanitarian, when you have an asylum, refugees, places that are, I mean, where peace is prevail, the social development, and also religion. But of course, this is not a short, this is a short list, but it's not a closed list. It can meet other explanations. The other assumption that I want to make is that the smugglers, the ones that are helping migrants to go from point A to point B, or from one country to another, usually are being considered by many people that they are nice people, that they are helping people to have a better life. But the experience that we have is that smugglers are usually criminals, especially the ones that are trafficking in persons that could be considered the mother of slavery. I mean, I'm talking about women that are absolutely, kidnapped for sexual purposes or for labor purposes, or children. And this is also a problem that we are facing in our times, and it's a very sensitive one. And the modern technology is simplifying immigration. It used to be a very important, huge change in the world when the vessels being modernized and the steam vessels move from, let's say, Rotterdam, if you go to the New York hotel where the boats left from Holland to America. Well, of course, the modern technology increased the migration, but also the modern technology is helping to control more and more the migrants. I think it's also very obvious. What is happening with the migration of Mexico to the US? Well, first of all, Mexican migration to the US is historical. We have been, moving people from Mexico to the US forever. We will see this in the presentation about the development of Mexico and the US in relation with migration. The economic and social factors are being essential for the migration of Mexicans to the US. As I have said before, I think we, at the end, in North America, we have a common labor region, and that's why the Mexican workforce is strongly present in the United States. The family reunification and the minors is also another example of the migration to the US, but also the repatriation. Mexico is a country where a lot of repatriation is taking place. And at the end, I will show this at the end of the presentation, the Mexican migration to the US is in decline. But also, we have to consider that not all migration from Mexico is from Mexicans. We have, and we will see why, a lot of people from all over the world that are using Mexico to go to the US and to the US, especially in a regular or undocumented fashion. When we're dealing with migration, and that's why my experience has been in consular affairs, is because, of course, we deal with the issuance of these documents that are necessary for moving, but also a very important activity that is the protection of Mexicans when they are abroad. Why they need a special protection? Well, because they are foreigners, because sometimes they don't speak the language, because they are in a much more vulnerable situation, and of course, certainly this is according to the Vienna Convention. And this doesn't mean that the protection is to take a person away from their responsibilities according to the law of the land. No, it's exactly just to be sure that the law is applied correctly, and that when a Mexican or a foreigner is facing a problem with justice, it is according to the due process of law. The consular tasks are also in the promotion business and in the community relations. This is very important, considering that we have a lot of Mexicans living in the US, and by a lot I mean millions. We have now 50 consulates of Mexico in the United States. These consulates provide advice and orientation to the Mexicans. We have now an information center that works 24 hours, 7 days a week, especially now because of the problem that the,
the Mexican migrants are facing. And what is essential for us is this institution that perhaps you have seen in your classes, the consular notification. What is the consular notification? When a migrant or a foreigner is arrested or is in the hands of the authorities of another country, the authorities are obliged to tell the foreigner that he or she can talk to the consulate of their country if they want to do that. Not every foreigner wants to call the consulate. We have cases, let's say, especially the criminals, drug traffickers, what they don't want is the consulars to be involved. But certainly the authorities are obliged to tell the person that he's been arrested that he has the chance to call the consulate, wherever the consulate is located. And we have, of course, different types of consular assistance, the advice, and orientation is the most strong word that we have, but also visiting hospitals, jails, the repatriation, and the signature of, the introduction to attorneys of law that they will take care of the cases that they are facing. And this is also a very sensitive point, the minors, especially now when minors are migrating without their parents because of many reasons, especially the separation of families. So the minors are a very sensitive point because when the minors are in the hands of the smugglers, the minors are usually in very bad hands. And finally, in the case of Mexico and the U.S., the death penalty cases, Mexico has no death penalty, but the U.S. has death penalty, and we have about, today could be around 40 people that are in death row. And I am not going to stop discussing the death penalty because that can take from us, let's say, a complete seminar. But what I can tell you is that the experience that we have is that many of the Mexicans that are facing death penalty, accused of terrible crimes, they didn't have the consular notification, they didn't got a consular official at the very beginning of their case, and usually are very poor people. Rich people will never face death penalty. I don't know why. And of course, Mexicans in the U.S. facing death penalty is according to the proportion of Mexicans in the U.S. The vast majority of people facing death penalty in the U.S. are Americans, of course. The governor, former governor of Texas, was asked in Mexico City, Texas is very death penalty is very popular in Texas, and he was asked what we should do in order to avoid that our Mexicans don't face death penalty in Texas. And the governor answered, "Don't mess with Texas." Okay. And he's now the Secretary of Energy in the administration. But look, where is Mexico? Well, we look at where the consulates of Mexico are. As you see, this is a very important network, and this has been explained because of the size of the Mexican population in the U.S. Just a few things about Mexico. We assume, as I told you at the beginning, that geography is all the consideration that should be taken place by politicians when they are enacting migration laws. Look where is Mexico. Mexico is the border with the most important magnet of migration, which is the United States. I don't think that there any ethnic group in the world that is not represented, migratory speaking, in the U.S. You will find people from all over the world, from all the religions of the world, from all the ethnic and racial groups in the world, in the U.S. The U.S. is a country of migrants, like it or not, but it's a country of migrants. And of course, our border means that we have to deal in our policy with a magnet, an attraction of migration, and that we have, of course, also to have in consideration that an enormous amount of people are trying to come to Mexico with the only single purpose to jump into the U.S. Sometimes illegally through this border, which is 3,000 kilometers. But also Mexico has a border with Central America and Latin America or Ibero-America, and also a border with the Caribbean. That makes Mexico a very important, strategically located, and of course our geographical situation has been something that always has defined our international policy.
look at our border. I am not going to stop anymore here, but this is a 1,000 kilometers border with Guatemala, a 300 kilometers border with Belize. Belize is a very small town. I think the population of Belize is smaller than the population in Maastricht, but Guatemala certainly is a country that now has 17 million of population and counting, because in Guatemala they don't believe in family planning. I don't know why, but they don't believe in that. And of course, the population growth is increasing, and that will be also for Mexico a tremendous pressure in migration, because they go from here to here, crossing this country, unless, of course, we can develop the economy of these countries. And for that, we need international cooperation and investment. This is a border, as you see. When I start my career in 1985, and then I left Los Angeles to become the Director General of Consular Affairs of Mexico, all the problems of migration were in this point, San Diego, Tijuana. All migrants from Mexico were crossing here. The migrants from Central America were crossing here, in this part of the country. Now, here, you will see that we have not a wall, but a fence. And this means that the migration moved east, especially now. But here, you see Tucson is very close to Mexico, but this is about 80 kilometers, but of desert. So it's not easy to walk here. But the fence, of course, are pushing migrants to move into more dangerous places. We will discuss this later. This is our southern border. Again, I'm not going to stop, and our Caribbean border. But this is about the figures of the Mexican economy. It's not bad. It's not, of course, the best one, but it's not bad. We are growing, and we have this is not a very easy figure, because we have not unemployment, but unfortunately we have a lot of people in the underground economy. But that is another. Our macroeconomic figures are under control, as you see, and exportations, thanks to NAFTA, that is now on the review, the free trade agreement. Look at these sizes of the economy. Our trade balance is in an imbalance, like in the U.S., but we have an imbalance for other reasons. And this figure is very interesting, $23.9 billion in 2016. These are the remittances of the migrants to Mexico. This is a very impressive figure. And of course, this money is being earned by the migrants. They already pay taxes for this money in the US, and they are helping the families of Mexico, sending this amount of money, usually using the banking system of the US. In the past, when I started in Los Angeles in 85, they usually sent money through very different channels that were very expensive. They were charged with very strong commissions, or sometimes they use people that were like couriers to take money, cash to Mexico, or sometimes they use the mail to send money. That, of course, is not anymore, but it's thanks to the banking system and the education that we are trying to do with our migrants to use the banks, which will give a better rate, and of course, the guarantee that the money will be arrived to Mexico. This is our external debt. Our debt, according to the gross domestic product, is really under control, is really low. The public deficit is lower than in many, many countries of the world. And the famous North America Free Trade Agreement that is under criticism today. I want you to take in consideration this. This is the gross domestic product, trillions. Look at the size of the economy of the US, look at the size of our economy, and look at the size of the economy of Canada. So the big neighbor, the big partner of this free trade agreement is the US. And now, since that they are the victims, I don't know why, but I don't believe that. Look at the size, look at the income. This is the income per capita, but in purchase parity, which is a measure that we have to do. How much money do I need to buy something specific in the US, in Mexico, or in Canada? And of course, Mexico is lower than these two, but Mexico is now number 13 in the world. So it's not bad. This figure is low, but it's not bad, and it's growing. important method. Okay, now let's move to the migration to the US. This is the population according to the federal census of 2010, the ancestry in the US. As I told you, the US is a country of migration or migrants. The Germans are number one. Of course, we have to put the English and American together, and then they are competing with the Germans. But the German migration that started well in the 19th century was the most important movement of people from the European continent to America. The African American are 45. Irish, that the premier of Ireland was about 3 days ago in the White House, and he requested some compassion for the 50,000 Irish undocumented aliens that are in the US. Mm-hmm. So they have undocumented. And of course, Mexicans now, we are at 31%. But look at this list, it's very interesting. As you see, in the Latino population, the most important one, the most important group is Mexican, but then we have Puerto Rican.
I've got a very quick question for you.
Yes.
How do you find American, how do you define the statistics?
This is an English also. Is
yeah,
what I read.
But you've got like Native Americans everything?
Native Americans are the indigenous of America when
so
they
refer to US American.
Oh?
Like it would refer to US American.
Well, the census, this is not me, I didn't
okay.
do this.
No, just
but there is the so called Indians. Huh? When the pilgrims arrived, the Native America were the ones that were the I don't know what this
yeah.
but this is according to the census, and I think it's the law of the census.
Yeah.
But they differentiate Native American and Alaska.
Mm-hmm.
And also they have the islands of the Pacific for Hawaii.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the US population, 10 main countries of origin, people that has been born outside of the United States in this year. We are champions here, 11.7. Then China, look at this. Guatemala, now appears Guatemala, and some other Latino countries. People that were born outside of the United States, 14.3 million in 2010. Of course, this is an old figure, but this is the only one that I got. But look, I think this hasn't changed. You see the difference between this graphic and the other. The other is ancestry. These are the ones that were born outside the US. They are, could be regular or irregular, it doesn't matter. Well, this is a very brief, let's say, history, we can say, about the migration movements to the US. The famous settlers, the pilgrims, then the slavery from Africa in 1619 started. At about 1700, the people living in the colonies were these figures, white and black. Then the Irish migration started. Then in 1840 until the First World War, a very important German migration. It is not Mexican migration at that time. Then in 1848, we finished a very unfair war, the Mexican-American War, and we lost these territories, Colorado, Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, and parts of Utah, Nevada. These were part of Mexico in the colony of Spain. And after our independence in 1821, our independence, of course, gave Mexico the new nation, all this territory. And this territory was lost by Mexico to the US in the so-called Mexican-American War that was ended in 1848. This war started because Texas claimed its independence and Mexico rejected that independence because Texas was part of Mexico, was part of the new Spain. The name of Mexico before being Mexican as an independent country was New Spain, a colony of Spain, and Texas was part of the colony of Spain as the same way that California and all these parts of the territory. Look at the size of the territory that we lost. However, we didn't have a lot of Mexicans living here at that time. This part of the territory of the new Spain and of the new nation, Mexico, was relatively isolated. And it was colonized by people that were coming from the east of the US, going south. And that's why at some point they claimed to be independent from Mexico.
in 1836, and then the Texas Republic lasts as an independent country for 10 years until 1846, and the war started, and we lost all this in 1848. But not big migration at that time. Then we have all these Chinese, the famous Statue of Liberty is here, Ellis Island is open. We have to move faster. We arrive to the first important migration of Mexicans to the US because of the First World War I. Mexican agricultural workers. It was a kind of bracero program, but was unilateral. The Mexicans were moving to the States because they have jobs, in mainly in the agricultural activities, because of course the Americans were fighting in Europe. And at that time with this famous coin of melting pot, this was a play in Broadway, the first mounted border patrol started. And in 1929, what do you remember what happened in 1929? The crisis, the economic crisis? It was enacted the Mexican Repatriation Act because of the economic crisis, and this sounds familiar. Sounds familiar, Mexicans blame for American unemployment. And get away from the US, go back to Mexico. That was it. And then, again, 1942, the Second World War, Mexicans were requested to work in the fields in the US because the Americans were soldiers in Europe, and we were invited to work as Mexican laborers, guest workers in the US. This program, didn't work very well because mainly of the common border that we have with the US, and a lot of employers prefer to hire illegal aliens cheaper than the Bracero program workers that were more expensive, because these were protected by the law. The others, of course, were irregular migrants, but that's why the program didn't work well. And in 54, once the war was over and the economic role of the war was taking place, operation went back. 1 million of Mexicans were deported. Sounds familiar again? As you see, there is nothing new under the sun. In the 60s, the Cuban Revolution, hundreds of thousands of, educated migrants, upper and middle class from Cuba, left the Castro government and went to the US. That's a huge difference because the Mexican workers were very humble people, perhaps not very well educated. They were rural workers. And sometimes they compare the Latino migration with the Cuban look. This was the elite of Cuba that left the country. In the case of Mexico, were the workers that left the country. And then, the migration from Cuba continued with the crisis of Mariel. You remember the crisis of Mariel? It was about 150,000 people from jails and mental institutions that were allowed by the government of Castro to leave Cuba and arrive to the US. And in 64, officially, the program of Bracero program ends. Vietnam, other group of migrants. Forget about this point. In 1986, the Simpson-Mazzoli Act was enacted, the Simpson-Rodino. Forget about this, this is a mistake. This law is a very important one. I was in Los Angeles when this law was enacted, and this law was important because it's the first time in the US migration legal history that employers can get sanctions for recruiting illegal immigrants. But on the other hand, the other side of the coin is that the law authorized the legalization of undocumented immigrants that enter the US before January 1st of 1982, that can reside continuously, not guilty of crimes, pay a fine, and they know something about US history. And also to legalize certain seasonal agricultural undocumented workers. This is very important because you have the stick and you have the carrot. The carrot was the legalization, and the total legalization was 2.6 million. This is legalization, sorry, it's a typing mistake. And undocumented from the urban centers, 1.5 million. And from the special agricultural workers, 1 million. In total, 2.6. This was the carrot. We are going to legalize all the migrants that were here before January 1st of 1982. Now, the stick. We are going to legalize these ones, but if you are an employer, you cannot recruit undocumented aliens, because that will be a misdemeanor at that time. Now it's a crime. But you will see the evolution of this. Then another law was enacted by the President Bush the father. I don't stop here. Another one was issued in 1996 by President Clinton. This benefited mainly Central America because of the crisis of natural disasters in 1996. And then, remember, 9/11. That changed a lot of things. The first is the Enhanced Border Security Act. And this law established that the different agencies will share data, and then they will see the social security, let's say, will be consulted by migration to see if that number of social security is regular, is real, or not. And they are sharing data with all the federal agencies in the sense that they can compare if they are not forging documents for getting an employment. And the travel documents will have to be machine readable, tamper resistant, and the biometric identifier. This was because of 9/11, of course. Then we have the Secure Border Initiative to increase the border patrol agents in 2005, expanded detention and removal capabilities, upgrade technology, investment in infrastructure to control, the increased interior enforcement of immigration laws. A lot of usually the enforcement of immigration laws were in the borders or in the ports of entry, but now they develop some enforcement in the interior of the United States. And in 2005, the Real ID Act, the criteria for states to make driver license and personal ID cards to be accepted by federal authorities, and the construction, we start here, for the barriers and roads along the land borders. So this wall is not necessarily new. But the important point is that after Simpson-Rodino in 1986, the employers used to argue, well, I'm not an expert in documents. If some worker arrived with a birth certificate in English, at least was born in America, I will take it for good, because I am not an expert in documents. Okay, you can hire him because he showed a photocopy of a birth certificate. Today they cannot do that because, of course, they have the technology and they have to make consultations to all the data to see if the social security number is a proper one or not. I have to move faster. That also, in 2010, I make a stop here because this is very important. The Arizona and some other states start with local laws that state that was a crime to be illegal according to the state law. I mean, the federal government is the one that has jurisdiction over migration in the U.S., but the states start with this kind of local laws that later on they were reviewed by the Supreme Court, and some of them were decided that be constitutional, others no. But this was very, very sensitive. They allow the Arizona police to question anyone that they think reasonable suspect of being illegal. Who? Well, of course, the ones that look Mexicans. They will be stopping the streets, and they will ask for the documents. And then we have the local police doing a job of the migration authorities. That's why I don't go to Arizona. No, they will stop. The point is that the local police was always reluctant to help the migration authorities, because if they don't get the trust of the community, then the communities where they are policing, they will suffer a lot of criminality because the victims, because the population that is irregular, they will not make any police report, and they will never testify, and they will never support the police because they are scared of the police. That's why it's very sensitive to ask the local police to do the job of migration authorities. This is also a very important example of the compassionate enactment of the laws and regulations. This was issued by President Obama, the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals. This is the case of a lot of children that arrived to the U.S. when they were before 60 years old, And they have been in the U.S. 5 years, and they are studying. But there is a point where they cannot continue their studies because they are being requested to produce documents to prove that they are legal in the U.S., the DREAM Act. So they are children that now they are teenagers that wants to be in the university, but they can't because they are illegals. But they arrived to the U.S. when they were 16 years old or younger. And they have no the authority to say to their parents, I'm not going with you. I mean, I was 1 year old, I cannot say my mother, don't take me to the U.S. because I have no papers, I have no visa. You're not going to say that. But this has been, this idea has been in the hands of the U.S. Congress for many, many years, but no one wants to produce a law of this idea. So President Obama decided to make a ruling, an administrative ruling, and allowing these dreamers to stay in the U.S. and to go to the universities. This is a very important point because as long as you have these children in the universities, first you have talent. Talent that is working in the U.S. and studying in the U.S. Secondly, you are taking children and teenagers outside the streets and to be members of the gangs in the streets. So it is a very important piece of, not legislation, it's not a law, but of regulation. Unfortunately, nobody knows what is going to happen with this now. This was the DREAM Act for parents, but it didn't prevail. The Supreme Court decided not to be. Okay, let's go to the figures. Unauthorized migration to the U.S. Look at the country resource U.S. Department. This was 2014. Well, we missed the date, but look. Unauthorized immigration. Mexico, this is the very high figure. 62% of unauthorized migration to the U.S. are from Mexico. Now, today, 2014, 2015 data. Then El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras. But look at the growth. This is 65% from 2000 to 2009. This is in decline, and this is growing. Look at the Honduras, Guatemala, and El Salvador. And then Philippines, India, 64%, Ecuador, Brazil, and China. These are the percentage of immigration, unauthorized, illegal migrants. And as I told you, 50,000 of Irish, according to the release of the figures by the Premier of Ireland. And in January 2012, data from the U.S. Department of Homeland Security, 11.4 million unauthorized migrants in the U.S. and 59% from Mexico. But you already saw the other countries. Yes.
How do the other how do people from India get to the U.S. It's still to the border. When you say unauthorized immigration, is it, do they not have a visa?
The Indians? There is a. I think I have is this. On how the unauthorized or illegal migrant go to the U.S. Enter the country without the government permission. After being lawfully admitted, let's say you have a visa to be a tourist, and you remain in the country beyond the period that you are authorized. This is most important source of immigration, of unauthorized immigration to the U.S., more than jumping the border, the common border with Mexico. A lot of people from all over the world, even from Mexico or Central America, go to the U.S. like tourists, and they stay. They stay forever. That's the way that the India and China and other countries that are very far away usually go to the U.S. Some of them are also using the border, the common border, the land border. But many of them are admitted legally and stay, overstay. It is being called the overstay visa.
How do they know this number? Is it Social Security?
This is a data from the U.S. Homeland Security Department. I think they were relying in statistics and in research methods made by some NGOs and some think tanks in the U.S., like the Migration Policy Center, and through interviews, I think mainly through interviews and some statistics technology. Yeah, but certainly this is not accurate. It couldn't be precise, exact. Now, this is a very polemic presentation.
What are the benefits of the immigration to the illegal immigration, unauthorized immigration to the U.S.? First, the participation in farms, restaurants, hotels, manufacturing, retail. They pay taxes. This is something that you have to keep in mind. Always, it has the tendency to think, well, the migrants don't pay taxes. Yes, they do. They do. I am talking about income tax, not the sales tax. Of course, they pay sales and property taxes if they buy a house, and they do. No, they pay income tax because they have to register themselves to get an employment, and they say, okay, I have a number. And they pay taxes under a different name, but they are paying taxes with the same money that they are earning. And they don't collect Social Security. Why? Because they have paying Social Security and income tax with a different name. So they will never get the benefit of the Social Security. It's a lie that they are costing money to the taxpayers. They are not. Perhaps, as Borja, one of the scholars in Harvard said, they are reducing the salaries of the non-skilled workforce, but the reduction of the salaries because of the phenomenon of the market is 5 to 10%, no more than that. Because unauthorized migrants are, of course, getting lower salaries than the migrants that are authorized. But these are part of the benefits of the unauthorized immigration. Hopefully, some people read about this because it's very important. The favorite topic now, the famous wall. This is not Mexico, this is China. But it's very old, and I think the policy is very old as well. It's useless. The wall started in 2006, it's nothing new. And even before. And it started in San Diego, Tijuana. And the fences are now in 1,126 kilometers of double lake fencing along the southern border. This act in 2006. But the fence also was accompanied by personnel and technology, of course. You don't leave a fence like that and don't make any surveillance on it. You have to have inspections and vigilance and technology. By 2017, the idea is that they will have 700 miles of fencing. This is not the wall, the fences that the government has already today. And of course, as I told you, they need to have surveillance in the fence and watch over sensors, flood lines, razor wire, all-terrain vehicles and air drones that they are using to see and to protect the common border. This is what is happening now. This is what is happening now. The famous new wall is this. Well, this is like it is now. This is the San Diego-Tijuana border. And as you see, this is the Pacific Ocean. And the fence is projecting into the sea for about 1 meters because some of the people were swimming to go to the other side. It's very dramatic. And this is also the highway in Tijuana. It's like it is now. And this is the kind of fence that exists today in the common border. So, the wall for what? The new wall is going to be from point to point, from San Diego to Brownfield. This is one point of Mexico to the other point. Double thick, very high, 9 meters, says. And the estimated cost by the administration is 8 to 12 billion, but MIT in Boston, they have a calculation of 27 to 40 billion dollars to build the famous new wall. The General Accounting Office in Washington, which is a very important institution that scrutinizes the function of the government, says that they have not recorded how useful has been the fences, if they are really useful or not. And there is no data that determine the extent to which border fencing divert illegal entrance into more rural and remote environment. The truth is that a lot of people is now using very dangerous places to cross the border because, of course, they have these fences in their traditional routes to the north. But again, this institution is putting in consideration the utility of that wall.
Now we have to the other point. One point of the control that the new administration is wanting to do is the wall, the other is removal. Look at this. I found this in the Washington Post in 2003, I guess, or 2004. Can you see? It is time to recover. And then the Indian said, well, okay, I help you pack, because I was here before you. No? And then every migrant is going to say, okay, I was first here, so you go. And who were first in the land? What are the removal consequences? Well, social problems. Of the Obama administration, only the Obama administration, the Democrat president, removed 3.4 million of Mexicans in his 8 years of government. But what are the consequences? Family separation, deportation of mothers. There's a lot of children that are U.S. citizens, but their parents are unauthorized migrants. What is going to happen with the children? Are the children going back to Mexico or to Central America? Certainly not. The parents are going to leave the children in the U.S. Why? Well, because they are studying, the schools are there, the doctor is there, because they were born there, and because they are U.S. citizens, according to the 14th Amendment of the U.S. Constitution. If you're born in the U.S., you are an American citizen. And then this is going to be a really, really very dramatic policy, because look at this, repatriation with children. I have a figure here. Migration Policy Institute is a very serious institute in Washington. Approximately 5 million children, U.S. citizens, live with one or two parents that are irregular migrants. 5 million of children, one, the father or the mother or both, are irregular migrants. If they are deported, what is going to happen with these 5 million of children? Well, this is the repatriations. I told you Obama administration was very active in deportations. Why was very active in deportations the Obama administration? Because they want to prove to Congress that they can handle the migration phenomenon, and then pushing the congressmen and the senators to issue a comprehensive immigration act. But unfortunately, that argument didn't prevail. What are the changes that the new administration is promoting? Well, before you can have an expedited removal, as long as the migrant was within the 100 miles of the border and in the country no more than 14 days. Today, it doesn't matter where you are, and it doesn't matter if you have 2 years in the country. This is the expedited removal. You don't have a chance for a hearing. You just have been arrested and you are deported. They are hiring 2,000 new immigration customs, expanding the number of detention facilities, and creating an office within the ICE to help families of those killed by undocumented migrants. This is not a crisis. It's very specific cases, but not a general cases. I mean, migrants are workers, they are not criminals. Before, of course, they have documents to the expedite removal. Now they have instructions to, they are recruiting police officers and sheriff deputies to help with deportation. Remember that I told you about the Arizona local law. Well, perhaps it can be transferred in a federal regulation, which is very sensitive. And some of the idea is also to return Central American refugees to wait in Mexico until they have a hearing in the U.S. Of course, for that, they will need the authorization from Mexico. Up to the moment, there is no changes in the deferred action for childhood. And the removal priority is for anyone convicted of any criminal offense, includes all governmental. Before, there was undocumented immigrants convicted of serious crimes. Today, it doesn't matter if it is a misdemeanor. And this is the policy and the consequences. Fear and anger among the migrant community. That is the problem that is happening today. A lot of people are really feeling bad and fear, because they cannot live quiet, they cannot live in peace, considering that they can be deported in any moment. I put the example of the Irish because it's not only a problem of Mexico, it's a problem of many other as well. Secretary Kelly was in Mexico City a month ago, and he spoke about the secure borders, that he assured that it will not be massive deportations. See? And that everything will be legal with respect for human rights and the legal system,
And this is very important, non-military force will be used in migration operations. This has been forbidden in the US for many, many years. But when the secretary was in Mexico, some media published news that they would use military force, but it's not the case, according to the assurances made by the secretary. What is our migration policy? And I will finish with this. Strengthening the international presence of Mexico, enhancing international cooperation, comprehensive promotion of the advantage, and protecting the interests of Mexico. This is one of our key important elements in our foreign policy, the protection of Mexicans. But what happens with Mexico? Mexico is a country of origin of migration, of transit of migrants, of destiny of migrants, and return of migrants. Migrants are, of course, for us, subjects of human rights, humanitarian enforcement of migration, and migrants have an important economic, cultural, and social contribution. It's something that we are. In 2011, we decriminalized the irregular migration. To be an irregular migrant in Mexico is not a crime. It used to be in the past. We changed the law in 2011. I'm going to move faster because we have, of course, a policy on refugee. One of the most important cases was the Guatemalan refugees running away from the civil war in Guatemala. About 80,000 of Guatemalans spent about 10 years in Mexico. All of them got land and work. And the ones that they were, the civil war in Guatemala was over, they came back to Guatemala. I was a witness of one ceremony with the president of Mexico in 2011, where many of the migrants, the refugees that were in Mexico, were now back in Guatemala, and they were very, expressed a lot of gratitude to the president of Mexico because they find a safe haven in Mexico, running away from the problems of Guatemala in the 80s. Our policy after the announcement of the new administration in the US. Well, respect of the rule of law of the migrants, respect of the human rights of the Mexican migrants, repatriation should be in an orderly and coordinated way. Because, of course, Mexico needs to verify that everyone that is repatriated, first of all, is Mexican. We are not in a position to accept people from other nationalities. And, of course, we ask for the approval of the protocols and agreements reaching the repatriations. We have places where the repatriations are taking place. We have also the schedule. We have hours where the repatriations took place. And then this is in a coordinated and efficient manner. And this is important, the free flow of remittances, because it has been some sounds in the air that the administration wants to tax the remittances of the workers to Mexico. I think that will be very difficult to do, and that will be inhuman, because that money is the salary of the people. They already pay taxes for that. It will be a double taxation. Some sounds, some people are arguing that. U.S. should work with Mexico to stop illegal flow of arms and money. Of course, as we didn't discuss in this talk about drugs and weapons, but it is one of the challenges of Mexico to stop drugs to the U.S. And the conviction that we have that the only way that we can develop Central American countries and stop the migration from Central America to the U.S. through Mexico is trying to develop the Central American countries and to find jobs there. That will be the only real solution for that. And for that, we have to work together with the US and with Mexico. Mexican migrants is in decline each year, but as you saw in the previous part of the presentation, the Central American countries are in the growing. Of course, this is very clear. We don't believe the walls. Our Foreign Affairs Secretary also was very much in the same fashion. We have to deal with the three main topics that we have with the Americans, the migration, security, and trade, in a comprehensive negotiation fashion. And
our main concerns is the treatment of immigrants, respect of human rights, and non-racial discrimination and deportations according to legal process. Obama deported 2.8 million to Mexico, and the repatriations with the of these people that were deported were, of course, in a coordinated fashion with Mexico, the way that we did in the past, and no nationals of a foreign country could be deported to Mexico.
Well, I think I will stop here. We are now working in some. This is a very important point. According to the Pew Research Center, which is a very important think tank in the U.S., the Mexican immigration is on decline. From 2007 to 2014, the number of Mexican immigrants living in the U.S. unauthorized has declined by 1 million. More non-Mexican than Mexico were apprehended at the U.S. border in 2016. Why is this? In part, is because of course, thanks to NAFTA and thanks to the industrial growing of Mexico. Mexico has a very diversified economy. The workers are staying in Mexico. They are not facing the necessity to migrate to the U.S. to have a decent salary. But this is, of course, is not the general situation. But the tendency is to have the Mexican migration in decline. And that is, of course, good news as long as we can keep the economy of Mexico growing. So these are the good news. We are working also in the multilateral arena in order to protect the human rights of the Mexican migrants. We have meetings with the Organization of American States, the Inter-American Human Rights Commission, the United Nations, and the idea is again to express our concern about the respect of the human rights of the Mexicans in the U.S. As you see, we have also meetings with the UN High Commissioner of Human Rights, and this is one of our most important preoccupations, the stigmatization of any groups, Mexicans, Muslims, as something that incites xenophobic abuse. And the consular activities are being increased. We have a budget increase in a moment that is not easy for us to devote more money for this kind of activities, but we are doing that. And the creating of a center for information, a toll-free number, a mobile consulate is taking the consulate services to the consular services to the communities where they are to intensify the expedition of documents. And I told you about the remittances here, the financial advice and the use of banking system, and a dialogue with the local authorities that usually are in the favor of the migrants. Okay, well, I will stop here to allow you to make or participate in Q&A and try to answer your points.